Hello, hockey fans. Welcome back into the Neutral Zone here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. We did it. We made it through the All-Star break. Very, very little NHL hockey last week. Followed up by the fun, festive, silly festivities of the All-Star break. But we made it through. We're back. We've got regular hockey on the board. Six games going on tonight. We will keep you updated on all those. Plus, we will take a look into the second half. What can we expect? Who's going to be making moves? Who's going to be buying and selling at the trade deadline? Who's looking up? Who's looking down? All that and more coming up here on the Neutral Zone. But we're not just going to be doing NHL tonight. We're going to be taking a peek in at some other stuff around the hockey world. We're going to be looking at some women's professional hockey as well while we're here tonight, as some of the more prominent stars of the women's game are starting to get some representation from major agencies. Could we be seeing something coming up in the women's game in the near future? All that and more coming on up. Don't go anywhere. Adam Karnick with you here tonight for the next hour or so right here in the Neutral Zone. And welcome on in, everyone, to the Neutral Zone here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. I am Adam Karnick. Zach Pupless has the night off tonight, but he'll be back with us next week, Tuesday, to go through some things there. Lots to get through as we get through tonight. Not our usual slate of overwhelming Tuesday hockey. That'll be next week on Valentine's Day, as seemingly the entire league will be in action next week, Tuesday. Now, tonight, we've just got six games in action that are all going on right now. None of them will probably be done by the time that we are off the air tonight, but we'll keep you up to date on all the scores as we go through. So glad that you are here with us tonight. Lots to talk about, lots of fun to be had, reviewing some of what happened during the All-Star break, some of the fun silliness that goes on there, plus some of the restart of the league. Some of the players talked about some improvements that they could see happening in the league, so we'll be looking at that. Plus, just all kinds of our usual, and our usual off kilter stuff that we do. It's a little harder to do just one person, but you can hop into the chat room and help keep that spark alive if you like, and we can banter back and forth that way. Before we get into that, though, we do need to get our homework out of the way. IE Sports Radio, of course, is available for you on all of the major social platforms, whether it's Twitter, TikTok, Instagram, Facebook. It is there for you to be found. Just search IE Sports Radio or go to our website, iesportsradio.com. For the last 8.5 years, IE Sports Radio has been bringing you amazing content, ranging from interviewing legendary athletes to building tailor-made shows dedicated to all major sports cities around the country. All the while, we've continued to be by the fans, for the fans, and with your help, we are ready to take the next step. When you go to our website, iesportsradio.com, you'll see our Patreon link with 5 different tiers. The first one starts at just $5 a month. This donation will get you a shout-out on every single one of our shows. Higher tiers include IE Sports Radio merchandise, access to our podcasting university, and even a chance to be featured on a segment of our flagship show, The Defining Moment. Thank you all very much for continuing to make IE Sports Radio your direct feed for all that is sports. I want to thank Bay Area Raised, MLOS Great, Key to the Gate, and our anonymous supporter on Patreon for helping to keep us moving in the right direction here on the station. All right. So we always like to start off the show by giving you the rundown. Who's playing tonight? What's happening? What are the active scores going on right now? Well, we've got a few different games going on in action tonight. Everybody, it seems. Yes, nobody's in an intermission right now. So we'll start with the game that's closest to being done. That would be the Tampa Bay Lightning taking on the San Jose Sharks. The Lightning are up 3-2 in that one at this point. They just are underway in the third period there. In that one, goals at this point, Tampa Bay was up 3-1 after one, but then a goal from Timo Meier of the Sharks on the power play made it 3-2. The Sharks, both of their goals tonight coming on the power play, and Tampa Bay added one with the man advantage earlier as well. So lots of penalty opportunities there for both teams involved there. Late in the second period, the Edmonton Oilers are leading the Detroit Red Wings 3-1, despite Detroit outshooting Edmonton 22-17 at this point. It was 1-0 at the end of one. Edmonton has put up three unanswered goals here in the second period and is on the man advantage here to close it out. They already had one power play goal in the period. Ryan McLeod got it, and then two goals from Warren Fegley to this point in the second period. So Edmonton up 3-1 in that one. Elsewhere, with just about a minute left in the second period, we've got the New York Islanders pounding the Seattle Kraken 4-0 going on in that one. The big one, Bo Horvat scoring his first goal as an Islander after coming over from Vancouver and then signing fresh paperwork to be long-term with the Islanders. Horvat got his first New York goal. We've also had goals from Zach Parise, Simon Holmstrom with a goal, and also Samuel Bolduc got his first goal of his career in that game earlier tonight. That was the first goal of the game. So the Islanders all over the Kraken in just about every way you can imagine in that one. Elsewhere in the league tonight, we've got the Golden Knights are pounding Nashville 4-1. They are almost 5 minutes into the second period. Nashville has just four shots on net for the entire game to this point. We are nearly 25 minutes of hockey. Nashville with just four shots. The Golden Knights have as many goals as the Predators do shots to this point. That is a beatdown to this point. And the Predators actually had a lead at one point in this one. Matt Duchene had the first goal of the night for the Predators. Since then, it has just been all Vegas tonight. Four different goal scorers, Amadio, Carrier, Kessel, and Stevenson all to this point with the scoring. We just had the first period wrap up between the Ducks and the Blackhawks. They are tied at nothing. And then underway in the third period now, the Colorado Avalanche, they lead the Pittsburgh Penguins 1-0. Nathan MacKinnon, the lone goal in that one. So we got a goalie fest going on there in Pittsburgh. As Pittsburgh hasn't gotten much going offensively, just 19 shots. But Casey DeSmith is keeping Pittsburgh alive. 34 saves already for DeSmith tonight on the night. So that is your quick rundown of everything going on in the league. And thank you to Taryn and Marcus for jumping into the chat room with us. If you are listening live here tonight, Tuesday night on Spreaker, hop on into the chat room. You can interact with us that way. We talk back and forth. Ways you can follow along with this show: we are available for you on Twitter at IESR Neutral Zone on Twitter. Or you can follow along with myself. I am at Adam_ Karnick. Zach is at the Pupless on Twitter. And Taryn is lamenting the fact that the second half has started, because that means he has to pay attention to his lowly Anaheim Ducks. Yeah, you know, they are not doing well, to say the least. But, you know, the Connor Bedard sweepstakes are always there for the taking. And Marcus Lohs, great salute to you, sir. Good to have you here. Marcus hosts Gloves Off here on Wednesday nights on IE Sports Radio. And, of course, when you're talking hockey, you know, the old joke always comes out that I went to a boxing match and suddenly a hockey game broke out. Doesn't happen as much anymore, but, you know, sometimes it works out that way with the hard hits and the fighting. The Detroit Red Wings just got themselves back into it. A goal with 10 seconds left in the second period. So as they head to the second intermission, the Oilers still up, but they're only up a goal now going into the final period. Joe Valeno, with his seventh of the season, gets Detroit to within a goal heading into the final period there. So lots going on in the hockey world tonight, even though only six games going on, but lots to keep up with. So the All-Star break, you know, we talked about this last week. All-Star breaks they're a lot of fun. They should be fun. They should be celebrations. It's my opinion on it as we look at these. I know all the major U.S. sports, you know, they do some kind of All-Star break, and by and large, the fans grumble about them. You know, we had the Pro Bowl games in the NFL over the weekend. Everybody was grumbling about the format. Oh, they're not playing real football. The NBA. Oh, the only thing that's worth watching in the NBA All-Star game is the dunk contest, and even that's no good anymore. Oh, there's no defense in the game. Baseball. Oh my God, what the hell are they thinking? It actually means something. Why do they? Major League Baseball's got it all wrong. The NHL. What? What even are they doing? They're playing three different games, and there's nobody understands what's going on. At the end of the day, this is supposed to be fun. It's a break for the players. It's a celebration of, hey, you physically made it here to this point in the season. You're putting your bodies through hell, night in, night out. You're traveling all around the country. You know, in the case of hockey, you're traveling between countries. You know, you're traveling internationally all the time. You play 82 of these silly things, and in the span of just a few months, it's supposed to be a chance to unwind, have some fun, and take a break. That's why it's called the All-Star Break. It's not supposed to be serious. It's not supposed to be something that gets people uptight and wound up over. Yet, every year, the same thing happens. It doesn't matter what the sport is. I get it. Nobody likes it. And admittedly, yes, I don't watch a ton of the All-Star festivities. I'll catch the highlights on social media or YouTube or NHL Network, you know, whatever the appropriate place may be. A lot of fun watching Ovechkin's kid take slapshot, you know, his 10-year-old out there already with a wicked wrister getting goals out there. That's what these are for. These are supposed to be fun. They're just supposed to be fun events. They're supposed to be silly, fun, entertaining. The NHL does take it up a notch by in the silliness factor, in making the constantly tinkering with the format. You know, now I kind of like what they have now in the sense that it's you basically you form teams within your division. and you play a little tournament. That's fine. It's fun. The three on three, I really like. I really like the 3-on-3 aspect of it, just simply because it opens the ice so much, and you allow these guys to show off a little bit, and that's inevitably what winds up happening, is they show off what they can do. And yeah, you wind up with some ridiculous scores, like Atlantic beating Metro 10-6, you know, in a 20-minute period. You had 16 goals, you know, or in over the course of two periods, you had 16 goals getting scored. Yeah, it winds up being ridiculous. You know, we had in the three little miniature games that they played in this, you wound up, and now I'm going to have to make myself do math, I apologize, 38 goals in the span of six periods. You know, yeah, it's ridiculous. But you know what? It was fun. It was exciting. You saw some crazy stuff. Matthew Tkachuk, good for him. You know, what was it? A 7-point night that he wound up with when all was said and done in the whole thing. Good for these guys. It was fun, entertaining. We move. Life goes on. We move on. There are far more important things, even just in sports, to get our gumption riled up than the All-Star festivities. You know, if you're getting worked up over the All-Star, over the All-Star breaks of whatever sport it is, whether it be hockey or whatever, take a chill pill. You know, it'll be fine. It was neat. Also, the ESPN took the opportunity to talk to a lot of the different players involved in the All-Star festivities and just kind of pick their brains a little bit about, you know, who some of their favorite teammates are, but then also more pertinent things of, like, should the NHL expand the playoff field? What's a town that you'd like to see an NHL city? You know, what's a new town or city you'd like to see an NHL team in? One thing that I found very interesting from that was, by and large, now the article from ESPN quotes six different players here for this question, but by and large, at least the six answers they chose to print, pretty much everybody was, no, you know what, leave the playoff field the way it is. 16's a good number. That you have eight in each conference, and the guy that kind of put it best, Chandler Stephenson from Vegas, I'm going to quote him directly. I think 16 is good. You're pretty beat up and exhausted at the end of it. It's a good sweet spot that they found. End quote from Chandler Stephenson of the Vegas Golden Knights. Yeah, if you expand it, even if you do like what Troy Terry of Anaheim talked about, bring up the NBA format where you have the play-in games, that's an extra two or three games on your body that you got to put in even just before the playoffs start. Yes, it's exciting. There's nothing like a game seven in the NHL playoffs. NHL game seven in the NHL is bar none, hands down, the best of the game sevens. I know I'm biased because I do a hockey show, but I'll stack up an NHL game seven against MLB, NBA all day long. You have the most excitement and drama in an NHL game seven. So I get where you'd come at with that idea of, hey, you know, here's an extra, a couple extra one and done style game seven games. But no, I think the NHL has found a nice sweet spot there with the 16. It's a little over half the league. It is, you know, of the, you know, 16 of the 30 teams make the playoffs. But I do like that by and large, the players are, we like them the way they are. I'm sure inevitably the playoffs will be expanded just because of the dollars. There's always the opportunity to make more money there, and you got to take that where you can get it. But I do like the field. I know Zach and I have debated back and forth about how the field should be formatted, but I even kind of like how they have it formatted, where you basically stay in the divisions for the most part until the very end. A lot of the players, when asked where would you expand, what city deserves an NHL team, a lot of people brought up Quebec City. Couple people brought up some northern game. Dylan Larkin of the Red Wings actually brought up Mexico City, not necessarily as a permanent home, but he brought up the global series of playing a game down in Mexico City. That would be interesting to have a hockey game in Mexico City. I mean, the griping of having a hockey team in Arizona, having even just a hockey game in Mexico City feels strange. A reporter tried to feed an answer to Seth Jones of the Blackhawks, suggesting Honolulu, and Jones shot that right down. Hawaii, that quote, the travel would be insane. I was trying to make it more realistic. Yeah, and again, yeah, that would be hockey in Honolulu. That would be interesting, to say the least. It's just interesting, but fun stuff from the All-Star festivities. Players get to chime in and weigh in on some things. You get the crazy festivities. You get kids coming out there playing on the ice. All good fun. We got through it. We all survived. Now we get to move back to our regularly scheduled hockey. We are going to take, at this point, we're going to take a quick break. And then on the flip side, I want to kind of go through some of the teams that are active tonight, but also just kind of review the standings and look at what some teams need to be doing. The Bruins in particular had a rough finish to the first half. What might we be expecting out of Boston as we get ready for the second half here? You are listening to The Neutral Zone here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. We'll be right back after this.
Attention, all sports fans! If you're someone who wakes up each morning with lists of sporting events to go along with your to-do list for the day, then you just might be a diehard. The world of sports is as vast as the ocean is deep, including the major leagues, the minor leagues, the colleagues, and everything in between. This is me, Bart Larry B of IE Sports Radio, welcoming you to join me every Monday evening at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern on The Defining Moment, a show that focuses on what really matters in the sports world, sports themselves, and nothing outside of them. Once again, tune in for The Defining Moment with me, Bart Larry B, every Monday evening at 4 p.m. Pacific, 7 p.m. Eastern on IE Sports Radio, right here on Spreaker.com. We'll see you there.
Everybody, this is Taryn Rodriguez. Are you a fan of volleyball? Are you a fan of thunderous spikes? Then I have the show for you. Set Point, where I cover NCAA men's and women's volleyball, high school boys and girls volleyball, beach volleyball, and even professional volleyball. Catch the action every week here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Spanish Top Flight is here on Well Into Sports Radio. From past champions like Barcelona and Atletico Madrid to current champions Real Madrid and every team in between trying to fight for Champions League glory and trying to fight against relegation. It's La Liga, right here on Wellington Sports Radio.
It's IE Sports Radio. It is your direct feed for all that is sports. It is Philly Sports Talk with Cash and Chris every Tuesday night right here on IE Sports Radio. Your direct feed for all that is sports. Philly Sports Talk with Cash and Chris is the most comprehensive view on Philadelphia sports exclusively right here on IE Sports Radio. You know what it is, your direct feed for all that is sports. Tuesday night, IE Sports Radio, Philly Sports Talk with Cash and Chris.
Fans, it's your boy Marcus Los Great here to give you what you want, here to give you what you need. Yeah, man. Yeah. I'm coming to you live, straight from your mama's basement with a crispy white tea. We are coming to you live every Tuesday at 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Powered by IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
And welcome back into the Neutral Zone here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports. So now that we have made it through the All-Star break and the All-Star festivities, what have we got in store for the second half? We're about a month, a little less than a month away from the NHL trade deadline. So, of course, we know there are teams that are going to be on the move. We've already seen a couple teams like the New York Islanders, for example, go out and already start looking at making some moves. Bo Horvath, who we talked about a little bit earlier tonight, they acquired him from Vancouver and then turned around and already signed him to an extension. We've got other teams like the Blackhawks or the Ducks who are probably going to, almost certainly going to be selling at the deadline. Guys like Max Domi, Jonathan Toews, Patrick Kane, a couple of defensemen from Anaheim, very possible. Guys like John Klingberg, Kevin Shattenkirk could be on the move elsewhere. Lots of things that could be happening over the course of the next month was as far as the trade market. One of the teams that almost certainly is going to be buying is going to be the Boston Bruins. The Bruins had just an insane first half. And especially when you consider, you know, where they were at the end of last season, you know, 107 points overall in the standings. Through the course of the entire season last year, through 51 games, they've got 83 points. They are 39-7-5 overall. A whopping 13 points in front of the Maple Leafs for first place in the Atlantic Division. And you know, certainly they're not going to be selling at the trade deadline. But you do kind of have to wonder. David Pastrnak has had a terrific season for the Bruins to this point. He is the team leader in points, goals, assists. 72 points he has played in all 51 games. Plus minus of 25. He's got 28 points on the power play that leads the team in that category. He's just having a remarkable season here. He's a pending free agent. Obviously, they're not going to be trading him. You know, they're not going to be moving him here at the deadline. But it is kind of surprising that they haven't locked him up to a deal at this point. Word out of Boston seems to be that it's coming. No need to be too uptight about it, but it's a situation worth monitoring, worth keeping an eye on there in Boston. But just wanted to go through some of the numbers from their first half. They are on pace currently for 63 wins on the season, which would be a record in the NHL. The current record is held by a couple of different teams. The Red Wings set it back in 95-96, 62-13-7. The Tampa Bay Lightning then tied it in 18-19 by going 62-16-4. So the Red Wings, more points in that season. The 83 points that they had puts them on pace for 133. That is also on pace to set a new NHL record. The current record holder there, the Montreal Canadiens, 76-77, had 132 points. That was only an 80-game season, by the way, for Montreal. The Bruins would be doing this with two more games. A goal differential of plus 81. 81 goal differential through 51 games. They're not just winning games. They are running away with games. Part of the reason for that is their goalie tandem. Linus Ullmark, Jeremy Swayman. They have combined for a save percentage of .930. Getting it done. These stats and figures, by the way, are all coming via ESPN. The league doesn't really keep track of this. According to ESPN's research and statistics, unofficially the best mark for a team's goalie tandem is a save percentage of .934. That was set by the St. Louis Blues back in the 68-69 season. Obviously, if you're saving a lot of goals, if you're saving a lot of shots, you're not giving up a whole lot of goals. The Bruins are giving up just 2.12 goals per game, easily the best in the NHL. Almost half a goal better than the next best team. The Dallas Stars are next, giving up 2.57, and then the Rangers at 2.59. Well off the pace, though. The best season goals against average for a season belongs to the 11-12 St. Louis Blues, a ridiculous 1.89 goals against average. But just a ridiculous first half for Boston. Now, they are off their next game isn't they've got a ways till their next game. Their first game of the second half isn't until Saturday. Saturday afternoon, they host the Washington Capitals, 3:30 Eastern time. So they've got a little bit of time here as the rest of the league kind of restarts and resets. The Bruins are off all the way until Saturday. But good times ahead in Boston. You would expect, I wouldn't be surprised if they try to make a move, but at the same time, you kind of look at what do they need. I don't know. They're doing, you know, what they need is really what they need is they just need to figure out something with Pasternak, really get that situation resolved and then understand what they're looking at cap wise and financial commitments there. But really they are doing fantastically well to this point in the season. Another division that's going to be worth keeping an eye on. We will stay out east. We'll look at the Metropolitan. My goodness, look at the Metropolitan. Of the seven teams in that division, currently five of them have winning records. Only the Flyers and the Blue Jackets are underwater in that division. The Flyers aren't that far underwater. They're 21, 22, and 9. You know, they've got 51 points in 52 games. They could very easily find themselves, you know, a win in their next game, and they're right back to 500. It's the Blue Jackets are the only team that you know unequivocally is out of it in that race at 15, 32, and 4. Meanwhile, everybody else in the Metro, it's going to be very interesting to see how aggressive some of these teams are. I mean, you've got Pittsburgh losing tonight. The Islanders are winning tonight. They're going to be jumping up. The Hurricanes wound up with some extra cap space all of a sudden. Max Pacioretty, you recall Zach and I talked about this earlier in the year. The Hurricanes acquired Max Pacioretty for literally nothing from Vegas. It was 100% a salary dump on Vegas's part. It was, hey, we literally can't afford his salary. Carolina, would you please take him off of our hands for us? We'll figure out the compensation later. And Carolina was, sure, we'd love to have a 20 goal scorer. Thank you very much. We appreciate that. Pacioretty was hurt at the time. He came back, played a game for Carolina, and he's hurt now and done for the season. He's not going to play the rest of the way. Well, the NHL has a funny little quirk then. The money, by placing Pacioretty on long-term injured reserve, that frees up his cap space. They suddenly have $7 million in cap space available to them to just spend. So we could see the Hurricanes be active here at the trade deadline. They've got a little bit more flexibility going on here. And with everybody being alive in that division, it's going to be really interesting to see what they do. Out west in the Central Division, it's a little more cut and dried. You still have, you've got three teams underwater in the Central of the eight teams in the Central Division. You've got five of them currently have winning records. Three are sub 500, the Blues, the Coyotes, and the Blackhawks. We know that the Blackhawks and the Coyotes are dead in the water. They're not doing anything. They're looking for Connor Bedard. They're hoping to sink to the bottom and win the lottery. St. Louis, probably the Blues are probably going to be looking to sell at the trade deadline. I can't imagine them being too aggressive. Nashville's getting waxed as we speak. Colorado's an interesting one. The defending champs are having a rough year. It's always hard to defend because every night you go out there, you've got a target on your back. They don't have Nazem Kadri. They lost him to Calgary. They lost their goalie. They've had some injuries. McKinnon was out for a while. It's going to be interesting to see what Colorado does. They're still, the Avalanche are still very much alive, but 11 points behind Dallas for first place in the Central, and two other teams in between the Avalanche and Dallas. They're right now, they're in the playoffs. I would imagine that the Avalanche still make it as we sit here, you know, just short of Valentine's Day. Yes, Larry, yes, the Ducks still suck. I'm getting to them. I'm getting there. I haven't quite got there yet. But I would still imagine Colorado makes the playoffs, but I don't know how much of a push the Avalanche can make. The Wild and the Jets, they're going to be fun to see what they do to try to improve their teams. The Wild especially have not been shy in the past about trying to make deals, trying to push to make improvements at the end. You remember last year they acquired Marc-Andre Fleury at the trade deadline. It wound up not working, but the move made all the sense in the world, and I was very high on Minnesota for making the move. I loved the move at the time. I liked the aggression. Minnesota likes making moves like that, so we should see what they do. Then out in the Pacific, Seattle, my goodness, where in the world did this Kraken team come from in the first half? 49 games, 63 points. Whoa, what a first half for the Kraken. Now, Seattle's not doing so great tonight. As we check over and look at the screen, yeah, they're still losing 4-0 to the Islanders. But I got to get back to that Vegas Nashville game before we get out of here. Holy cow! So they're not doing super well tonight, but overall, this has been an amazing first half for Seattle. Very interested to see how aggressive they want to be. Obviously, last year they were sellers at the trade deadline. I mean, heck, they traded away their first ever captain. You know, he was captain for all of half a season, and then he was gone. It'll be very interesting to see what Seattle does. The Kings, I would expect the Kings to be very aggressive. You know, they're right there tied with Seattle. I would expect them to be very aggressive. Vegas and Edmonton. Vegas and Edmonton. This is interesting. Vegas right now is just a point out of first, but they're also only 2 points out of fourth, which does not guarantee them a playoff spot. They would still be in the playoffs as one of the wild cards at 62 points, even if they were to fall back behind Edmonton in the standings. But yeah, it Vegas and Edmonton are interesting. I know that Kale is going to be coming up right after us here in about 15 minutes talking Vegas, and I'm sure he's going to be talking a lot of Raiders football. Derek Carr rumors swirling about. It sounds like there may be a team interested in his services, but I know he'll also be talking Golden Knights. He loves talking hockey. Kale actually used to be one of the former hosts of this show, The Neutral Zone, in a prior iteration of it. I know he loves talking hockey. He always talks about how he feels that Vegas is the cream of the West. If they go on a little bit of a slide here, as they're up 4-1 after two, and they are just absolutely obliterating the Predators, as Taryn so aptly put it in the chat room, the Predators are now the prey. They are dominating that game. Yes, they've got the Ducks and the Sharks later this month, but they've got some tough games. Oh, we will not, and I'm getting notified, we will not have Sin City Sports tonight. Kale is unfortunately not going to be able to go live. But so we are it then for IE Sports Radio tonight. yes, they've got the Ducks and the Sharks coming up, but they've got a game against the Wild here in a couple of nights in Minnesota. Then they play the Lightning, the Flames, the Stars, and the Avs to wrap up the month. It's very possible in those seven games, they might only come out with 5 or 6 points. It's entirely possible if they go on a little bit of a dry spell. I would not be shocked if Vegas decides to kind of back it off a little bit here and maybe not necessarily full out sell, but certainly not go too aggressively to buy. This division has gotten crazy tight, crazy fast, and if you go on, it's only going to take one bad slide to suddenly have one of these teams wind up looking up at a lot of teams. So it's going to be very interesting. I could see Vegas not necessarily being super aggressive at the trade deadline before all is said and done, depending on how the rest of this month goes. It's going to be very interesting to watch the Pacific Division specifically here as we finish out February, just because of how close everybody is. I mean, you have 1 point separating first from third. All right. You'd have to finish in the top three in your division to guarantee a playoff spot. 3 points separates first from fourth. Now you're talking wild card. And then it's only 5 points separates first from fifth. So it's going to be very interesting to see. You could, with a couple of bad weeks, you could suddenly find yourself looking up at a lot of teams. Yeah, then you got Vancouver, San Jose, and Anaheim. They're all done. Vancouver's already started selling. The Sharks are going to be selling. Anaheim is going to be selling. Anaheim is hoping against hope to land Connor, but you know, to get the ping pong balls for the lottery to bounce their way. But the Pacific Division is going to be really interesting to pay attention to here over the next couple of weeks as we get ready for the trade deadline. All right, we are going to take one more break. We'll do a wrap up of some scores. We have a game that actually went to overtime, so we'll get you caught up on the scores around the league, and then a non-NHL story to finish out our night. This is the Neutral Zone here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
What is going on, everybody? My name is Harrison Glazer, and we're coming at you from the Show That Never Sleeps podcast. I cover the Jets, the Islanders, the Nets, and the Yankees.
This is Pierre Moss, and I cover the Mets, Knicks, Rangers, and the Giants.
Our show is live every Wednesday through Spreaker and a bunch of other ways to get our content. Again, we're the Show That Never Sleeps podcast. We talk about all those New York sports. It's a lot of fun. We get into all of it. Please tune in. Again, that's Wednesdays at 6 p.m.
And we look forward to having you guys right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
What's up, sports fans? You're looking for a different type of sports talk show, something you haven't heard before? You gotta check out the BS3 Sports Show every other Saturday on Two Live Stews Radio, 1 p.m. Central Time, 2 p.m. Eastern. Sports talk at its finest. Always have great guests playing some good hip-hop. You don't want to miss it. make sure to tune in to the BS3 Sports Show every other Saturday at 1 p.m. Central Time, 2 p.m. Eastern.
Sports fans, are you looking for a sports show that maybe isn't 100% about sports?
Then you might want to check out the Sports Couple Perspectives right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Most sports shows cover only scores and stats, and while we're not opposed to that, we dig a little deeper into sports issues and some of the hottest topics in athletics.
In addition to sports, we take a journey through my neck of the woods, pop culture, with movie reviews of both sports and non-sports films.
Speaking of pop culture, make sure to participate in our game nights, where we quiz each other on our specialties, and you, the listeners, can win IE Sports Radio apparel.
We always have a great time learning more about each other's worlds, one show at a time.
So join us each week on the Sports Couple Perspectives, right here on IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
Sports takes many form, and there's one show on IE Sports Radio that's ready to cover it all.
I sure hope you're talking about you and I, Daryl, because I know the Extra Mile is the best place to go for everything motorsports related.
Yes, it is. From NASCAR to IndyCar to sports cars to everything in between, IE Sports Radio has everything covered for the fastest sport in the world.
Plus, don't forget all of our random shenanigans along the way.
That's right, Caitlin. So for plenty of motorsports coverage and plenty of Caitlinisms, check out The Extra Mile on IE Sports Radio with Daryl Kinsey Jr. and Caitlin Seen, Thursdays at 8 p.m.
Hello, ladies and sinners. Hello, sports fans around the world. Hello, IE Sports family. This is Cale Henderson, the host of IE Vegas, the Sin City Sports Show, presented by IE Sports Radio. If you folks are interested in sports in the Vegas area, if you're wanting to have a blast for 1 hour, every Tuesday night from 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time to 8 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, this is a show built for the Vegas sports fans, where we feature the Las Vegas Raiders, the Las Vegas Golden Knights, the Las Vegas Aces, and the University of Las Vegas, Nevada Rebels. Hopefully, fingers crossed, MLB team coming soon. Either way, if you folks are looking to have a blast for 1 hour each and every week, tune in Tuesday, 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time to 8 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. If you folks are interested in Vegas sports news, go to our Twitter, at SinCities_IESR, and you can speak with me, the host, Cale Henderson, at Cale_Henderson on Twitter. At any time, be happy to reply. Always willing to reach out to our fans. Again, the Sin City Sports Show, presented by IE Sports Radio, your direct feed for all that is sports.
And welcome back to the Neutral Zone here, everyone. Adam Koenig with you here for just a few more minutes. Unfortunately, Cale Henderson will not be going live tonight. He's having some power issues. So no Sin City Sports tonight. So we will wrap things up here for IE Sports Radio as a network tonight here on the Neutral Zone. Want to say thank you again to our Patreon supporters, Bay Area Raised, M. Los Great, Key to the Gate, and Anonymous for your support. If you would like to support us on Patreon, go to our website, iesportsradio.com. Starts at just $5 a month. And then you too could hear me give you a shout out on our show every week. Thank you to those that do. And for those that don't, please consider it. All right. Take a quick gander around the scoreboard. We did have a couple of games go final during the show tonight. Both went to overtime, so a couple of three-point games. The Pittsburgh Penguins came back and beat the Avalanche 2-1 in overtime. Brian Rust with the tying goal, just under 4 minutes left to go in regulation. And then Chris Letang got his fifth goal of the season home in overtime with just a minute and a half left to go in the overtime to give the Penguins the winner. So the Penguins win 2-1 in overtime. And then also in overtime, the Sharks came back from behind. They were down 3-1 after one. And the Sharks won it 4-3 in overtime. Jonah Gadjevich tied things up early on in the third period. And then in overtime, his second goal of the night, his 30th goal of the season, Timo Meier with the game winner, 2 minutes and 19 seconds into overtime, got the Sharks the winning goal. Elsewhere, we have in the third period, the Golden Knights still hammering the Predators 4-1. Nashville, just six shots to this point. We are 41 minutes into the hockey game. The Predators have only six shots on net to this point. Things are about to go final in New York as the Islanders are all over the Kraken, 4-0 on that one. Midway through the third period, the Oilers still hang on to a 3-2 lead over Detroit. Detroit is on the power play. They have about a minute and 20 seconds left to go in that. And then in Chicago, with 3.5 minutes to go in the second, the Ducks and the Blackhawks are tied at 2 goals apiece. 18 shots for the Ducks, 15 for the Blackhawks. Jason Megna, his first goal of the season, tied things up at two. We also had Seth Jones with a goal for the Blackhawks. The Ducks have yet to lead. The Blackhawks led 1-0 and 2-1, but Anaheim never let it get more than a one goal lead. So that is our wrap up for the night. So wanted to finish things out before we get out of here. Wanted to go out of the NHL for just a minute and go to the Premier Hockey League for just a minute. We were going to talk about it on last week's show, and then unfortunately the show kind of got away from us. It happens sometimes, unfortunately. Creative Artists Agency, or they're a lot of times they're just commonly referred to as CAA. They're one of the biggest sports agencies in the United States. And it came out just at the end of January that they now are representing women hockey players. They have 8 women on their roster. They include Blair Turnbull. She is a 2-time Olympic medalist with Team Canada. Hannah Bilka. She is the captain of the Boston College women's hockey team. The other members of it, as I go through the article. There we go. Goalie Aaron Frankel, Patty Kazmaier, or excuse me, Aaron Frankel was the 2021 Patty Kazmaier winner. Claire Thompson is also on the roster there of the women's players. So 8 members, and they're working to get more membership. The Premier Hockey Federation, they are the only women's professional league in North America. It's in its 8th season of existence. They're trying to get larger, trying to do more. They have a plan to expand their right now. Their goal is to expand their salary cap from $750,000 to $1.5 million for next season. However, this is a step to try and just gain more viability for the professional women's game. I remember last year during the Olympics, you had the gold medal game between Canada and the U.S. was a huge event. The numbers were, it drew 3.5 million viewers just on NBC. That's just in the United States. I mean, it outdrew NHL games. There is a bit of an appetite for professional women's hockey. U.S. and Canada played a game out in Seattle just a couple of months ago that drew the largest attendance ever for a women's hockey game in the United States, 14,551 fans. So there's a push going on here. A quote from CAA Hockey, Jen Kardash, she's the head of operations at CAA Hockey. Women's hockey has grown immensely in the last 20 years, but still has a long way to go. We are excited to use the experience we have from the men's game to help these women grow their personal brands while also helping with the overall growth of the game. So some strides being made there. The Professional Hockey Federation, in case you're wondering just what the teams are, as I pull it up here real quick. There we go. The Premier Hockey Federation, their teams are there we go. They have seven teams: the Buttes, the Force, the Pride, the Riveters, Toronto, Whale, and the Whitecaps. So they are primarily based out of the Northeast. That's where most of their teams are. Buffalo is one. Toronto, Montreal, a lot of being in the Northeast portion of the U.S. and Canada, but it'll be interesting to keep an eye on, and interesting to see where this goes and where this leads, hopefully to bigger and better things for the women's game. All right. You heard the horn. That means we got to get out of here. It is time. Big thank you again to all of our Patreon supporters, Bay Area Raised, MLO's Great, Key to the Gate, and Anonymous for your support. Thank you to Taryn Rodriguez, to Larry B., and to Marcus Los Great for hanging out with us in the chat room tonight. Thank you, Larry, for all the work you are doing behind the scenes, sir, getting the website, giving the website a facelift on there, and working to bring in new hosts, new talent to the IE Sports Radio roster, new cities, new shows all the time. So thank you, sir, for that. Finally, thank you for hanging out and listening with us here tonight, either live on Tuesday night or later on in the week as a podcast. However you absorb the content, thank you for making this show part of your week. It is very much appreciated. Next week, it's Valentine's Day next Tuesday. We're going to have to work that into the show somehow. Some players, some why do we love hockey? How do I love thee? Let me count the ways. Oh man, we got all kinds of fun that we'll have in store for that show. A special Valentine's Day edition of the Neutral Zone. Zach will be back next week, so it'll be the two of us going on and giving you the banter that you have come to expect from us week in and week out. Of course, we'll be keeping you updated on everything going on in the NHL, and we'll see what other fun and crazy things happen along the way. For Zach Pupless, I am Adam Karnick. This has been the Neutral Zone. As always, thank you for listening. Stay out of trouble, stay out of the penalty box, and be sure to protect your five hole. We'll see you next week, everybody.